St. Paul tells us in the Bible, if a man don't work, that man don't eat. Or some translations more accurately say, if a man's not willing to work. I know a lot of wounded veterans and a lot of disabled people that would love to work if they could. But this has been the American way of life for most of our country until the socialists got into government. But most of us still believe that a man should work and provide for his family. And I say this to qualify this video because someone may be watching that thinks I should be working and I'm waiting for an owner to get in. With my job, sometimes you can't make a delivery without the owner's approval. You can't get a sale without the owner's approval. So we're at the mercy of decision makers. So I just want to qualify that. So Donald Trump the other night posted that there's no doubt in his mind, I'm paraphrasing, I forget the exact quote, that it was God alone that protected his life. He told a reporter, the doctor said it's a complete miracle the way the bullet hit me. It didn't just graze him, it actually pierced his ear. He got a guy that never had his ear pierced, got his ear pierced with a bullet at 78 years old. And the doctor said if he would, he just turned his head at the right, he said he believes it was providence, it was God's will. And I believe it too. But when you say that, people's like, well, what about that poor father? What a good father. His daughter said, my father was the best father ever. He was the most loving father. I knew my father loved me unconditionally. He was always there for me. And he literally took a bullet for me. When we knew there was shooting, my father threw me and my mother down and he shielded our bodies and literally took a bullet for me. The man was a volunteer firefighter, always looking out for other people. Why would God protect President Trump but not protect this good father? That's a question in a lot of people's minds, and I'm gonna give you my opinion. But this wasn't the first time God protected our leaders miraculously. Back in the day, Theodore Roosevelt was shot. He was about to give a speech and he was shot in the chest. He knew he was shot and he looked and he realized that he had an eyeglass case and a really thick speech. He had like a couple hundred page speech, and the bullet slowed down so it didn't pierce any of his organs. It got stuck in his chest. But he said he's not going to let that stop him. He's going to give his speech anyway. He showed people the glasses and the hole in the paper. And they seen the man who did it. I think the guy like ran a bar or something or worked in a bar. And they were about to grab him and lynch him. They're about to hang this guy. That's how they did it back in the day. And Teddy Roosevelt said, leave that man alone. Leave that man alone. Don't hurt him. And eventually a judge heard him plead guilty. And he said, no, you're not guilty. You're insane. And they try to get the guy help. But even further back than that, you know, I always on like patriotic holidays, I always read the letters of George Washington. He wrote one letter to his younger brother, John. And he said, this was in the war, the Indian War, when they were fighting the American Indians. And he said, I watched as every officer around me got shot and fell. He said, I had two horses shot from beneath me. When the battle was over, I took off my shirt and I had four bullet holes in the chest. But by God's providence, I wasn't touched. I was untouched. Later, when the war ended, an Indian chief sought him out and met him and said, I was at that battle and my shooters never miss. And I said, the guys on the horses are their leaders, shoot them. And we shot everyone down and you wouldn't go down. So I said, all guns on that man. And when I seen that they couldn't hurt you, I said, this man is protected by God. And I knew one day you would become a great leader. This was before he became a great leader. This was before the Revolutionary War. But why didn't God protect those other officers all around them fallen? Well, Isaiah tells us this. He says, God's thoughts are not our thoughts. God's ways are not our ways. You know, we have, as human beings, we think, even as Christians, we talk about eternity, but we're always fixed on the here and now. You know, if you take great care of yourself, you don't drink, you don't smoke, you exercise, you eat organic, you can live to be 100 years old. Like an active, I know active 100-year-old guys that I see at the gym. Literally. Because they've taken care of themselves their whole lives. But that's nothing compared to eternity. Imagine 200 years, 300 years, 1,000 years, 1 trillion years. God sees things eternally. That's why the psalmist says the death of his saints. God loves the death of his saints. The death of his saints are precious in the sight of the Lord. Some versions put it, when God's servants die, it delights the Lord. Why would God love to see us die? Because he knows eternity is so much better. 1 trillion years of happiness, joy, and peace compared to 100 years of hardship, some good times, some bad times. You have to start looking at life eternally when you're a Christian. And why did God protect Donald Trump? Because, you know, if you're an American, you see these past 4 years, 3.5 years under Biden's been hardship for all of us. I'm looking at going back to a second job. I mean, and I'm not alone. I know a lot of you guys are struggling too financially. And all the protections Trump put to, you know, the taxpayers didn't pay for abortions overseas, Biden lifted them and is adding more money. More human life is being killed, you know. Another 4 years of Biden would be horrible. So I believe this is why he protected him. And I know, you know, people say, well, he's a bad guy. Jesus said, nobody's good. There's no good man but God, you know. The psalmist says all men are liars, you know. But sometimes God shapes people, you know. Character is built through adversity. There has never been a man, I've been a political nerd my whole life. There's never been a politician scrutinized and attacked more than Donald Trump, whether you love him or not. You cannot deny this. And his children, you know, Donald Jr. has like over 400 lawsuits, frivolous lawsuits. He's constantly, it's called lawfare. They try and break you financially, you know. Eric, the same way. They just keep attacking him. They know they don't have a case, but they make him pay for lawyers to fight him, you know. And the media lies and just, they get people to hate him, you know. They get, you know, they call him Hitler. Well, who wouldn't be a hero killing Hitler, you know? A lot of people think, you know, the Democrats, you know, set this up, but I don't think they set it up. But I think it's their fault because always calling this guy Hitler, you know, so you think you're a hero. You know, if I was alive during World War II and I had a chance to take out Hitler, I would have taken him out, you know? But they, you know, the left, like, dehumanizes him. And but now by God's grace, he's humanized. People are like, wow, he's just a man. He's actually a damn tough man, a warrior. He got shot and stood up in defiance and put his fist up like power to the people, you know. So maybe this is why God allowed it, you know. Maybe he wanted to bring home that fireman, you know. I don't know, you know. God's ways are not my ways, they're not your ways. But I do believe that it was a miracle that God protected Donald Trump. And his wife, who never, you know, she never gets involved in politics. She just said, I'm too busy taking care of Barron. For the first time, she made a public statement. It was beautiful. It made me cry. She said, mine and Barron's life would have changed forever. You know, she talked about what a wonderful dad he was, you know. And she's a Catholic, you know. And I know, you know, people say, oh, Trump's no Christian. You know, he grew up Protestant, but, you know, like a lot of Americans, they believe in God, but God isn't the center of their life. You know, I was that way. You know, I kind of believed in God until Navy boot camp, and I made God the center of my life. But God brings adversity to people to bring them to himself. Paul says in Romans, it's the kindness of God that leads us to repentance. God was so kind to President Trump, and he knows it, and he's thankful. And an interesting thing I noticed, usually in Republican National Conventions, it's opened by a Baptist preacher. You know, Billy Graham used to always open with prayer. And last night they had the Archbishop, the Catholic Archbishop of Milwaukee, open the convention up in prayer. And he said a perfect prayer. It was like perfect. It was beautiful. And then, you know, he picked Mike Pence last time, a devout evangelical Christian, a really devout Christian who put God at the center of his life as his vice president. This time he picks J.D. Vance, a devout Catholic. And you see where I'm going here, but I was kind of disappointed in J.D. Vance. I like him. I think he's a great guy. Great, you know, I'm 100% with him. But as far as winning, I'm in it to win it. And I didn't think he would be the best guy to win it. I really, you know, you heard me say a couple times, I think Glenn Youngkin should be the pick. Because we're like so close in Virginia. And Glenn Youngkin is a popular governor of Virginia. We win Virginia, it's lights out, it's game over. So I thought he would be the best pick. I thought Marco Rubio would be a great pick just because he's a phenomenal speaker and debater. And he's a solid conservative that speaks Spanish, so he'd get the Spanish vote. And I thought Tim Scott would be a great one. And after listening to Tim Scott last night, I felt like I was back in a Baptist church here and a preacher. He was phenomenal. And, you know, and of course, he would help with the African-American vote and the evangelical vote. So I was kind of like, man, why did he pick JD? I like JD, but that's not going to help him. But I have to admit, I didn't know a lot about his life. I just knew about him since he's been a senator. And I watched a trailer about his life called Hillbilly Elegy. I'm going to, you know, as soon as I get a chance, I very rarely get a chance to watch TV, but as soon as I get a chance to watch it, it's free on Netflix. I'm going to check it out. But then I started studying his life. And this guy had it rough. He grew up in Appalachian. I got one of my subscribers from the Appalachian, a really smart guy. And if you're there, you know, give me a thumbs up or a, hey, yeah, that's me. And I know how rough it is. I have a friend whose father grew up in the Appalachian Mountains. These are the poorest people in America. They're not the dumbest people, as, you know, the media would make them out, dumb hillbillies. You know, he said he was called a hillbilly. He was called white trash. His father was in prison. His mother was a drug addict. His grandmother basically raised him dirt poor. He said more people in his county die every year of drug overdoses than natural causes. But, you know, he was a Christian, a Protestant, kind of fundamentalist, you know. The Bible says that I believe that's final. That's how he was raised. And then he went to the United States Marine Corps, became a United States military fighting man, a U.S. Marine. Hoorah. And he fought in the war, the Iraq War, came home and went to college, got a bachelor's degree, I think, in political science, and then got accepted into Yale University and got a law degree from Yale University, and then became a successful businessman. And then he ran for Senate and won. And this is why Trump picked him. Trump's son, Donald Jr., said he wanted Bergman. He's like, Dad, what are you doing? J.D. Vance. And I could picture my kids doing this with me, you know, because he's tight with his sons, like I'm tight with my sons. And he said, a friend, you know, anonymous friend said that when they told him he wanted Doug Berman, they said, like, you're crazy. It's J.D. Vance. And they started shouting, J.D. Eric and Donald Jr. were like, J.D., 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 J.D. And so his father started looking at the life of J.D. and says, wow, this guy is like the epitome of America. And this is Donald Trump. America. His vision of Donald Trump is everyone can be successful. You know, Ronald Reagan said, a high tide raises every boat. You know, the Democrats are like, pit us against each other. You know, we got to take from people that work hard and give it to people that don't want to work. And, they say the rich to the poor. And, you know, they pit us against each other. Race, income, and Republicanism, the American way is no, everybody has an opportunity. We don't want to play favorites, but we want to give everybody an equal opportunity. And this is what he's all about, you know. And Tim Scott would have been the epitome of this as well. But right now, Ohio, Pennsylvania, Wisconsin are three must-win states that it looks like we're going to win, but they're close. They're really close. And this is the area that he's from, like right in the middle of all that. And he knows what's plaguing that is the drugs coming over the border, the fentanyl, the heroin coming over, killing all these people because the economy's so bad. Men are getting depressed. They're getting hurt. They're taking pills for their pain and they're dying. So he can relate to these people. He can go talk to these people. He can win us those three states. So in reality, it was a good political choice too. But at a deeper level, at a more important level, I read the reason J.D. became Catholic was because he read the Confessions of St. Augustine. And he said St. Augustine of Hippo evangelized him and made him Catholic. He said, you know, where I grew up, people really didn't have a deep understanding of Christianity, a deep understanding of the Christian faith. So when I was around people at Yale, I didn't have any good arguments. I didn't have any good reasons. You know, I was losing my faith. But then when I read St. Augustine's, I realized our faith, the Christian faith, the Catholic faith from the very beginning is reasonable, logical, philosophical. It's brilliant. And then when I talked to other Catholics, I seen, yes, this is true. The Catholic faith is the one holy Catholic apostolic church. This is the true church. So he's not just a Catholic. He's a strong Catholic. He's a revert. He's a convert like Marco Rubio. The same thing happened to Marco Rubio. Same thing happened to me. Even though I was baptized Catholic, I was an evangelical like he described for like 30 years. But the truth of the Catholic faith brings strong Christians into the Catholic faith. That's why I always say weak Catholics become Protestants, you know. Strong Protestants become Catholics. Unfortunately, some weak Catholics become schismatics too, but generally they become Protestants. But strong Protestants that truly love the Lord and want to know the truth and search out the history of the church become Catholic. So what I thought was a bad pick strategically, even though I like the guy, turns out was a brilliant pick. And I'm not saying Trump is that smart. I think God is that smart. And God's, you know, God chooses who our leaders are, and he chose J.D. Vance. And I can see J.D. Vance being president in when Trump's term is over for 8 years. So God bless America and stay Catholic.